altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that.
Only a holy God. be seated, folks. Kind lady. All right, I'm on mass for a few moments. Good morning. Good morning. Hey, before we get to our message, a couple little brief announcements. I want you to remember our friend Lynn Gillis. There she is, a picture we showed you last week. So Lynn is in the hospital now. She had some real issues the past couple of days. She was in ICU the last we heard. We don't have not a lot of information on her, but please, I want to ask you to uplift her in prayer. We've done a lot of work in her apartment to clean it up, to make it safer. She's wheelchair bound. So just keep her in mind. This has been her life. She's gone through a lot of trials in her life. So remember that. And I also want you to remember Dita. I've got no further update from her. I have a text to Philip because I think he's business. I don't know if she's had an appendicitis operation yet or not. But let's do remember her in prayer in here because it's a serious thing with the two children. And as we find out more information, isn't it always nice when you can do something for someone? I'm a doer, you know? I like to do something. You know, they need food or something, I can do that. You need something fixed, I can do that. Sitting back is just hard for me. But, you know, God has a way of straightening you out. And the last thing I want to mention, I got to put my mask on for just one moment. Bill, you're in the house, aren't you? Bill's in the house. Bill, could you pop up here for one moment, please? I have something for you. As you know, come on up, Bill. Come on up. Hey, you're a famous guy. You've been on TV before. Come join me. For one moment. We can't shake hands. We can't hug. I know all that. We got our rules down. But, Bill, we did that drive-by birthday for you, right? And there's that picture for you. Bill's 90th birthday party in the front of the fire truck. That's for you. Can go up with all the other pictures in your place. Okay?
That's where everybody came.
Oh, it was a great time. Thank you.
Made my life.
It's funny. Bill didn't know I was going to give that to him. When I met him coming in, and he was just telling me all about reading the birthday card he got and all the signatures on there. And he said it was just the greatest thing for him. Then we got to give him a picture. It's kind of cool. All right, so today, let's get to the message. Let's get to business, huh? That's why we came here. Came for the show. A walk in unity. We're going to be in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. We're going to read all six verses, but only go through the first two, and we're not going to make it all the way through the first two. There's so much information contained in here. Even what I'm doing is going to be a little bit superficial. It really will be, but this message has an abundance of information in it. And, you know, when you give a message, when I stand up here and I chat, my goal is to deliver a message in a way, in a time frame, that you can absorb it and stay focused. So let's say the message is about 30 minutes plus or minus 5 minutes, right? That's right, my goal is, you know. I try not to go to an hour, and I haven't, by the way. So don't you even go there, and I've got it on tape. I'm fairly short. I'm not prideful of that, but 30 minutes, that's the length of a sitcom on TV. Do you ever think about that? Sitcom. And we're not going to add any commercials in either, so don't think of that. But however, I want to suggest to you this. We need to be in the Word of God. We need to be in the Word of God the rest of the week. Because if you're not in the Word of God, I'm going to encourage you this, then this will become a sitcom. Because if you're only fed by what I'm saying, you are starving. You are starving. This is sort of like something extra where you get to kick back and listen, really, if you think about it. But one thing will happen if you're not in the Word of God, and if it's not real in our lives, one thing will happen for sure is that you'll turn the channel. You'll stop listening to God. Not me. It's not about me. This is about God. I want to encourage you to be in the Word of God. And if you have challenges getting into the Word of God, you just need to say, hey, Pete, I've got a challenge getting into the Word of God. We'll find ways to get you in there. We'll. It's so much fun. It's so exciting. So we're going to come to the book of Ephesians. We're in it now. And it sort of is in two parts, Ephesians. Chapters 1 to 3, they're the doctrinal part of the book, or the teaching chapters. Doctrine is instruction, especially as it applies to lifestyles. Doctrine is a set of ideas and beliefs that are taught and believed to be true. That's what a doctrine is. And biblical doctrine really helps us understand God's will in our life. chapters 4 to 6, when we're getting to 4 now, perhaps describes our duty or how we're to conduct ourselves. These chapters will help us to understand how to live out our lives. So the first three chapters are our identity in Christ. The last three are sort of our practical response to the first three. Now, there's those that take offense to the very thought that the church will tell me what to do, how to conduct myself. Because we don't like to be told what to do. Right? Right. But the premise of the argument is wrong. First, God is the administrator of the code of the conduct, not the church. Other than the errors that I speak up here, I'm parroting what God said. I'm fallible. We can erase my errors, but God's word's true. And that's the conduct we want to adhere to. It really is. Secondly, if you're upset with being told what to do, I'm using that sort of in a negative context, I guess, but there's an underlying attitude that you might have of not wanting to be told what to do, not listening, in particular in how to treat other people. And that reveals an issue of the heart. Pride. Pride in the world is like a preemptive military strike. You know what it really is? It says, you know what it says? It says, I don't want to hear what you have to say. I don't even want to hear it. And people will do that at times. They're not interested in what you want to say. The main reason why people are like that is they don't want to change. Think about that. I don't want to hear what you have to say. And that is a part of the condition of human beings, I think. But if you join any organization or you go to work someplace or whatever, don't you have to adhere to the codes and rules and everything that goes on there, right? You do. If you go to work someplace now, you put on your mask, right? You no mask, no work. It's as simple. It's there. It really is. Even the professional sports players, right? The hotshot, the superstars, they must submit to the head coach. Ask any Patriot player. You do what Bill says, right? Because Bill is the sovereign. Bill Belichick tells you what to do, or you are off the Patriots team. It's how it works. But we don't want to be told what to do, yet we have a desire to be accepted. Even macho men, macho men, I love men because I can pick on them. I'm one of them. It's easy. Men will say, I don't care what they think. They don't want to do those. Doesn't make any difference to me. Whatever. If I get a chance, if I become supreme ruler of the earth, I'm going to remove the term whatever from the Bible, from the dictionary. People just use whatever all the time. It's a riot. Whatever. Let's think a little bit more before we say whatever. It just gets me. But don't tell me what to do and accept me. Makes unity impossible. It really does. And in the church, it's not a question of being told what to do. As we'll see, it's a matter of doing what God has called us to do as co-heirs with Christ. People will also go to great lengths to be accepted and not be rejected. Recall Jesus, he healed a blind man who was blind from birth in John chapter 9. And the Pharisees brought the parents before them to question them about this. And in John, and they were scared, and they said, don't ask us, go talk to our son. Ask him what happened there. They said this in John 9:22. His parents said these things because they feared the Jews. The Jews had agreed already that if anyone confessed that he was Christ, he would be put out of the synagogue. That's a legitimate fear, I think. It really is. Churches can act that way, you know. Yeah, churches can be this way too. Fear of rejection can create very unhealthy loyalties in a church. We can state our commitments to doctrinal principles. We know what we believe. We believe what we believe. But do we do what we believe? Do we show what we believe? Are we truly committed? I know it, but do I show it? And show is the subject of this text that we're going to be in. Because in chapters 4 to 6, the admonition is to walk in unity, in purity, in harmony, in victory. That'll be the roadmap that Paul's going to be unrolling for us. So if you recall, if you haven't seen it yet, I emailed to everyone the sermon notes because I am greatly concerned about us as a body being into the Word of God. I really am. So you have my sermon notes. I've sent them to you. And if there's a better mechanism for doing this in timing, I will do that. There's nothing magical about my message. But it is from the Word of God. And my desire as a pastor is to have everyone in the Word of God. There will never be unity in our walk unless we are all in the Word of God. That much I know is true. It is beyond any disputation. We need to be in the Word of God. So have a look at those to find out what we're to do. But we're going to get to our text. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord, I thank you for this morning to be here. I'm thankful for those who come out gathered. What an encouragement, Lord, to see brothers and sisters here, to be in your word. Let us just be a blessed time, Father. It always is when we're with you. We're called by you, Lord. Guide me as I speak, Father. Have the words to say and have hearts ready to accept it, Lord, that we'll walk in unity. Thank you, Father. Amen. We're talking about unity. It's kind of funny. You know, you're standing up here, right? We have unity. Boy, we're spread out. It is so funny. We get a lot of unity. We do. It's in the spirit. I get it. But it is funny when you're up here that your perspective is totally different. And we're doing a great job spreading out aces to us all. And I love the masks, as always. Love the masks. But if you will, if you have your Bible, I'm going to read through Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. We're only going to be in mostly chapters 1 to 2, okay? But in Ephesians 4, starting in verse 1, it says, I therefore, Paul, a prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling of which you were called, with all lowliness, gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. There you have it. There's our text. But we're only going to be in the first couple of verses. And the first verse is in Ephesians 4, 1. It says, I therefore, Paul, a prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which we have called. So when he says therefore, remember when you come to Scripture, you ever see therefore? Therefore means because of what I just said back here, I'm going to tell you something here, okay? It's a bridge. Therefore, because of what I told you in chapters 1 to 3, he didn't say chapters. I'm going to give you chapters 1 to 4, 4 to 6. He's going to continue on. It's important for us to remember that when we read, because it's going to be a revealed process. The admonition is to walk worthy in our daily conduct. This isn't hard, but we make it hard. It's about our conduct today, real time. Not something futuristic. It's about that life we were called to. Called is past tense. We were called to this. This is the believer's call and a believer's walk. Let's keep in mind the scenario. We're in Ephesus, right? The Jews and the Gentiles are now together. There will be unity. How is there going to possibly be unity with the Jews and the Gentiles together? It's the Hatfields and the McCoys, right? We don't get along. God said something different. We have a nation right now that is not unified. We have a nation that's full of anger. We have riots. We have a situation that appears completely insurmountable. Is there hope? Is it in government? Is it in people? I'm a person. I'll fail you. I'm a pretty good guy. Most of you would agree I'm a pretty good guy, huh? Right? I will fail you. You can put some hope in me. Don't put too much hope in me. See, this message is about unity in the church. God's principles are supreme. We need to remember that. When we hit verse 2, think about how God's way is the only way to heal and to unify. God is love. Love is doing the utmost good for someone else. I keep saying this, I think, every single week. It is done through Jesus Christ. It is more than enough to unify. To have unity, something has to change. And it's more than the colors on the wall of the church building or the comfort of the pews. See, what needs to change are the saints that are sitting in the pews and the guy behind the pulpit. We need to change at times. We need to change because God doesn't change. He's immutable. To have unity, they have to change. To walk, we are to walk worthy as a fellow heir of Christ must do. And keep this in mind. We are fellow heirs with Christ. We need to think that way because it's instructive. How often do you or do I, as we go through our daily walk, do we think of ourselves as a fellow heir of Jesus Christ? Not very often. Imagine if we did, how that might change how we walk. It really may. We put a lot of emphasis on living for ourselves, don't we? I want to do what I want to do, when I want to do it, and how I want to do it. I'm an American. I can do that. And we call that liberty. An honest assessment of living for yourself will show it's a disaster. Living for yourself means you're living alone. You're living outside the loving bonds of God if you're living for yourself. There is no Our Father in living for yourself. Our Father who art in heaven, when you're living for yourself, you can't make that statement. I keep on coming back to that over and over too. Some of these things are so profound. I glanced over it. I said the Lord's pattern of prayer my whole life, and I finally am starting to understand what Our Father is. I might be slow. But happiness is fleeting, and joy is impossible if you're living on your own, for yourself. It's a self-imposed prison. There are no bars, and you're the warden. But in John 8:31, it says this, "Then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free." See, truth is the great escape. Without truth, one has to carry one's own burdens all the days of their life. Truth does not rob one of one's liberty. No, it doesn't. It leads one to the only place where liberty can be found. Walk worthy is our calling in liberty. Some of the highs and lows of living for yourself, if you live for yourself, you're going to carry all your own burdens and regrets. There is no forgiveness. The world will tell you, oh, you just need to forgive yourself. Just forgive yourself. That lasts, gives you a little temporary relief, but then you remember it because you weren't really forgiven. You're picking it up again. When God forgives us, He takes it, He forgets it, and He never charges us with that again, that sin. That's why God's forgiveness works. When we live for ourselves, we can have anxiety because we have the anxiety of being our own provider. I have to provide for me completely because I'm not depending on God. There's a lot of anxiety with that. If you're living for yourself, you're going to try to figure out life. What is life? The question that's been asked over and over, right? What about death? There's a distinct difference if you go to a funeral where someone is saved versus someone is not saved. If you go to a Christian funeral, it truly is a celebration of their life. There are tears, but there is genuine joy. I've been to funerals where they're not saved, and it's downright depressing. It just is. You just got to call it what it is. Tone of a Christian funeral is different because we understand life and death. And we don't worry about things that are out of our control. There's things we simply can't control. Isn't it great to just give them to God rather than hold on to them? We're called to walk in unity. And Paul tells us what unity will look like, how the dynamics will work. I got to say, have you ever seen an 8-man crew boat? They're incredible. They're incredible. They epitomize unity. If you've never seen one, go to the head of the Charles Regatta in the spring or just go down to the Charles River Basin. 8 men or 8 women stroking in the water. There's one coxswain in the back. What are they saying? Stroke. And their goal is unity. Those oars are up out of the water, they're into the water, they're out of the water, they're into the water, no splashing. Unity is their goal. It's an amazing thing to watch an 8-man crew boat going down the river, gliding as though it's on air. That's what it does. Unity. You can picture it. It's just beautiful. Which brings us to humility. In Ephesians 4, chapter 2, I mean, 4, 2, it says, "With all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing one another in love." Lowliness means humility. We don't usually use the term lowliness. It's humility. And it's been said of humility, if you know you've got humility, you don't got humility, right? It's a cute little cliche. There's a lot of truth in that. But it's a good way to measure your heart. It really is. the Methodist, the man who founded the Methodist Christian religion, John Wesley, in the 1700s, he had an interesting observation. I was studying this. He said this. He said that he observed that neither the Romans nor the Greeks had a word for humility. Think about that. Their language doesn't have a word for humility. We have a word for humility. Do we have humility? It really is this. And what is humility? When we think about the crown, that humility's crown is joy. Joy. Jesus first, others next, you last. That's on the sign out front this week. Jesus first, others next, you last. That's where humility gets its traction. It really does. If we can put Jesus first, and we care about others, and we're last, that's showing humility, esteeming others better than ourselves. That's real joy. That's not happiness. Happiness is fleeting. That's where joy comes from. And we have humility, and we have pride. In Romans 12:3, it says, "For I say, through the grace given me, to everyone who is among you, do not think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt each one a measure of faith." It sounds so good to say that. I'm not going to think of myself better than anyone else. Don't get uppity, right? They want to get uppity. But the world exalts pride, doesn't it? Not humility. It's not there. If you have humility, you're sort of swimming upstream. It's a tough stroke. If you're in your job, you're doing a great job. You're the best. You do everything. It's good, okay? But what happens when you receive no recognition or no compensation? Kind of stinks, huh? You don't want to advertise yourself. And then imagine what would happen if you found out that your boss was taking the credit for everything. You know, that happened to me. A number of years ago, I was working and doing things. I'm oblivious. I just go along. I'm doing all this work and stuff. I'm breaking new protocols, new methodologies and stuff. I'm having a good time. I'm working in a lab. I've got the best equipment in the world. I'm a geek. What do I know? One of my coworkers says, you know, so-and-so, the big boss, has been taking all of your work, your protocols, bringing them to national meetings and presenting it as their own. I looked and go, oh, I go. You know what was cool? There wasn't a ripple in my countenance. Maybe 10 years before, my pride would have kicked in. Oh, it was so good. God was in control of Pete. I like it when I'm not in control and God is. I wasn't upset at all. It didn't make any difference. It just rolled off. Didn't make any difference. It's a wonderful thing when we're in God's hand. You can't be hurt that way. You can't be hurt. Our humility in the world will make us invisible, potentially, in the world. Our good works will go unnoticed. There's no advertisements. But what's the image of humility do we want to have? In Matthew 6:3, it says, "But when you do a charitable deed, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, that your charitable deeds may be in secret, that your Father who sees in secret will himself reward you openly." That is what our goal is. That's where humility really, really goes to. You're not worried about anything. It's done in secret. It doesn't make any difference. You don't need to have any accolades given to you. After all, who do we want to see our good works? I want God to see them. Because they're of him in the first place. He's ascribed them to us. And when we start thinking of ourselves, where we start commending ourselves, we have a tendency to commend ourselves. And 2 Corinthians says, "For we dare not class ourselves or compare ourselves with those who commend themselves, but they are measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are not wise." I mean, can you imagine what would have been happening in the Ephesian church if the Jews and the Gentiles started comparing themselves to each other? "You weren't born a Jew. You're not as good as me. How about the Gentile?" "Yeah, but I was just called by God. You can't be as good as me." No, commending ourselves? Come on, we need to not be there. Which brings us to meekness. We have humility, now we have meekness. Once again, Ephesians 4:2, it says, "With all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love." Gentleness is meekness. is what it is. It's gentleness. It's power under control. It's having the right or the power to do something, but refraining from the benefit to benefit someone else. We just don't need to justify ourselves. Being of the very nature of God, Jesus had the right to do whatever he wanted, but for our sake, he submitted to the death on the cross. That is the ultimate in meekness. And meekness is great freedom. If Jesus Christ has justified me, then when the waves of the world start crashing over me, when I receive persecution, when I'm ridiculed for my faith, maybe I'm hated, maybe there's going to be some false accusations made against me. I have the power of God with me. I have that meekness. And meekness is a product of humility. Meekness is self-control, and that's the opposite of vindictiveness and vengeance. I must continually exercise meekness in my walk. That I is you as well. When meekness is my practice, meekness is my guide, invisible in my countenance. It's not a superpower that we just invoke when a villain shows up. I can't all of a sudden decide to say, I'm going to be meek now. It's not how it works. It's not how it works. Christ that dwells in us brings meekness to the surface of our lives, and meekness will identify us. It is our image when we have meekness. And I personally, I don't know about you, I constantly have to restudy meekness. Am I bad? I have to restudy meekness all the time. I have a challenge with the definition of it and retaining it in my mind. And I thought of it as a negative, but perhaps that's a strengthening of the Holy Spirit that compels me to continually work to understand meekness. How's your understanding of meekness today? Mine waffles at times. Being in God's Word will reveal things about you that are hidden to you. Do we understand meekness? At times I struggle. As I have an illustration for you, this preacher was walking down the street with his son. And a man came up to him and started speaking with them, and he started speaking to the preacher. And he asked the preacher, he said, well, what do you think of this man that has these terrible things to say about you, that's at odds with you, and all the, and just goes on for a little bit, ramshackling rant about this man that's mad at the preacher. And the preacher said something along the lines, he said, I think he's a good man. So the second man eventually, walks away, he does. And the son then says to him, I thought that man hated you and he couldn't stand you. Why were you so complimentary towards him when you were asked what you thought of him? To which the preacher said, because, son, I wasn't asked what his opinion was of me, but what my opinion was of him. When we choose to direct our power to be constructive rather than destructive, that does not display weakness, but meekness, controlled strength. What would your answer have been to your child? Think about that. Elizabeth Elliot, that's the wife of Jim Elliot. They were the couple that went to Ecuador. They were missionaries to this group of people that have never been touched by the gospel. And Jim Elliot died at the point of a spear down there, right? And they continued to work down there. His wife did and stuff. But she has a great definition for meekness. She says, meekness is teachability. It is the readiness to be shown, which includes the readiness to lay down my fixed notions, my objections. It is a child's glad, show me. Is this the way? Please help me. What a great definition for meekness. In the Garden of Gethsemane, the soldiers came to arrest Jesus. Peter went out there to do violence to them, didn't he? He took out his sword. Jesus told them, put up your sword. If you live by the sword, you will die by the sword. Violence isn't the answer, what Jesus told Peter. Instead, Jesus' meekness was on display. Or do you think that I cannot pray now to my Father and he will provide me more than 12 legions of angels? Isn't that great? Jesus showing what meekness really is. Power under control. He refused to use his power that was accessible to him. But he made it clear that he had that so they would understand it. That was written there for our admonition, so we understand that. That wasn't a pride issue. That was a, we understand, oh yes, there's power there. How are you going to use your power? The mark of true meekness is self-control. If a person, that's us, is angered by every inconvenience, they lack meekness. If that's you, don't despair. When the Word of God reveals something to a believer and our shortcomings, that's for our own good. It really is. If you see that there. If I lack humility, then I lack meekness. If I do not esteem others better than myself, I am certain to use my power inappropriately towards others because I don't know how to use my power. And the third point of this section of text is patience. Ephesians 4:2, with all lowliness, gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing one another in love. Long-suffering is patience. The real meaning of the word is long-tempered, which is not something we usually use, long-tempered. That does not mean, sometimes people say, well, you know what? You know, I'm a patient person. It takes me a long time to get upset. But boy, when I get upset, you better look out because you're going down. That is dumb as a box of rocks. Think about it, right? We do that. You know what that is?
I've never said it.
You know what that is? That's pure pride. That's all that is. There it is. No, that's not long-tempered. That's foolishness. Go to Proverbs. Read Proverbs. Go to Proverbs. Do all 34, 31 verses. You'll see what I mean. That's what we do sometimes, though. You know, we think it is. You better watch out. A patient saint accepts God's plan for everything. No complaints. If the calling is not glamorous, no complaints. In our walk, remember that Christ left his heavenly home for us to be hated, to be rejected, to be spat on. Not too many people know what it is to be spat on. Trust me, it's not nice. You don't want to be spat on. Christ did this without returning evil for evil or complaining to the Father. See, most people see patience as a passive and waiting, gentle tolerance process, you know? It'll take some time for them to come around. Just be quiet with them and go through. It's going to take them time, relax. They'll come around. There are absolutely times where that is true. There is. Sometimes you just need to be quiet and sit with a person. Just be patient. They're hurting. They're this. Be patient. Be quiet. It'll take them time. But that's not all the time. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 14, it says, now we exhort you, brethren, warn those who are unruly, comfort the faint-hearted, uphold the weak, and be patient with all. Well, that's a little bit of a twist on patience, huh? There's a little bit of activity happening here. This is a tough scenario that will require patience to walk through. But to preserve unity in the church and the unity anywhere, the unruly person needs to be dealt with. Oh, that sounds like fun. let me. No. What's unruly? Unruly is disorderly, disruptive, not amenable to discipline or control. And this can happen in the church. It's happened here. I've been here a long time. Lots of stuff's happened here. People are people. A person might be just hard to manage. This person is pushing to the edge of Christian acceptability. You might say, well, am I the person to deal with this unruly person? If for some reason I can't deal with them calmly, someone is truly unruly, I might ask myself, why can't I? A little self-reflection, right? Why can't I deal with them? If someone is unruly, do I become unruly in response to their actions? You know, fight fire with fire. Well, if they're going to say that, I'll say this. We know these things, don't we? You can begin to see the practicality of these verses. These things I'm saying, they're around us all the time. How do we maintain unity? It can be hard. In James 3:8, it says, no man can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. Isn't that true sometimes? Don't you wish you could have just take those words back, and you just can't. You just can't. Patience is hard. The tongue in the church can be evil. It can be without God. To maintain unity, we need to tame the unruly is hard. If I love someone, am I willing to warn them regarding their actions, though? Am I willing to go to them in private and have a hard conversation? Then there's those that said in 1 Thessalonians that are faint-hearted. That's referred to. Sometimes you see some of these words and you need to try, what does that mean exactly? Small-souled is another word for this. Small-souled. A person that lives in fear, they will be persecuted for their beliefs if someone is faint-hearted. See, their faith remains hidden. Their faith remains hidden. This person is hiding their light under a bushel. No one can see that. See, they'll come into the building, right? They'll sing some songs, but they're invisible for Christ as soon as they step out of here. In all honesty, you can't say that's okay. I know I want to. Oh, it's okay. You can't. Why? Matthew 10:32 says, therefore, whoever confesses me before men, him I also will confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, him also I will deny before my Father. This does not mean that you have to go preach on a street corner. This is not what we have to do. But we have to be visible for Christ in some way, manner, or form. No, we do. But with patience, to have unity, we must strengthen each other to be witnesses. Love the faint-hearted so they will have the blessings that God has in store for them. We need to come alongside them and spend time. The faint-hearted person needs to be encouraged in their faith. They need to be discipled. They need to be mentored. They need to be able to reach a point in their life where they can maybe just say, God bless you. That's it. But they need our help. They need our love for unity. Sometimes I ask myself the question, am I faint-hearted? I don't like asking that question. And in the last point in that Thessalonian verse, it says, the weak. The weak are those who have trouble abandoning sin and being obedient to God. That's someone who is weak. The challenge is to love them and strengthen them while not permitting the sin to permeate the church. Think about that. If I have a hard time controlling my sin and you're trying to help me, you got to make sure my sin doesn't hit everyone, right? We know one bad apple, the whole barrel gets messed up. And there's truth to these things. See, exercising patience is not passive. It can be very, very active. It is long-tempered. I would never use that term in a sentence, but how better can you characterize patience? Long-tempered. You're under control. You have meekness. You have humility. Remembering the goal is unity in the church. It's not about me. It's not about making the church a group of people that I want to see. No. No. It's about a walk that's worthy for those who are called. The pastor can call no one. The pastor can save no one. Neither can any one of us. It's about God's calling and how we maintain that unity and spread the gospel light. So let's finish with this little couple of thoughts. If a forensics analysis, something that's going to go to court, was done of your life, which was inclusive of your physical walk, your emotional walk, and your spiritual walk, what kind of trail would the forensic bloodhound follow? What kind of trail do you leave behind yourself? Are the attributes of humility, of meekness and patience so evident in our lives that you'd be easy to find? You see what I'm getting at? Do people know, hey, yeah, that guy, he's got humility, he's got patience. You can see it. You can see it easily. See, our Father, God is over all. He's through all. He's in all. We are God created, God loved, God saved, God fathered, God sustained. We are one people under God. The church is one body, and it's called to be united. Let these three attributes of humility and meekness and patience be a launch pad for our unity. How we treat each other will spill over into the world as well. It'll be so evident. The world needs to see Christ today. The church is God's vehicle to a broken world. We need to be unified. It's so important. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. I'm thank you for your teachings that we have, Father. They're so important. Please help us to remember what it is to have humility, to be meek, to have patience, and that we would treat one another this way, and the whole world would see it here at Calvary and want to know what it is that we have, because we have you. We thank and we praise you, Father, for your goodness. In your Son's precious name we pray. Amen. So you good? You all right? Hope I didn't step on anyone's toes too hard. I don't mind stepping on toes if it's for the right reason, though. It's okay. It really is. Because we do need to do the self-examination. We need to have unity among ourselves. But we have a few little bits of information to do. What we should probably do first is have an offering, don't you think? Could I get a couple of gentlemen to take up an offering, please? Henry, would you please? And the guys are just going to hold the plate out to you. You don't need to touch the plate. If you have an offering to go in there, just pop it in there. Everyone just has to put in just about $1 million. That'll be fine. That'll be fine. It's just money, guys. Can't take it with you. Henry, would you please pray right through your mask? If you can, pull it down if you need to.
I can pray right through it. Father, we thank you, Lord, for today's message about unity, Lord. We ask that you would help us to apply it this week as we enter the workplace. Gifts and the offerings that we're giving to you this morning, Lord, that they would glorify and magnify you in all things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And I just have one brief announcement, and an email will go to everyone. So tomorrow night at 6 p.m., if you're available, we're going to try and move some more of Teresa's stuff into her pod to help her out. She does a very good job. She had everything packed nice. We just had to bring it out there. I don't know how much there'll be, but if you can, I'll put an email out on that. And if we get done quick, we'll go get a pizza and eat on the sidewalk.